Hello everyone and welcome to VLAN Tech Corner. My previous video regarding the NanoPi R4S received a lot of attention. Therefore, I decided to make a video with the NanoPi R2S. In this video, let's take a look at the device and its performance with OpenWRT. The NanoPi R2S is powered by the Rockchip RK3328 SoC. It has 4 cores running at 1.3 GHz. According to the datasheet of the SoC, it can go up to 1.5 GHz. The board also got 1 GB of DDR4 RAM, which should be enough to run OpenWRT. Speaking about the I/O, the NanoPi R2S had 2 Gigabit Ethernet ports with WAN and LAN label, 1 USB Type-C connector to powering on the board, 1 microSD card slot to boot up your operating system, and a USB 2.0 to connect all the peripherals, such as an LTE USB modem or a USB wireless adapter. There is also a reset button next to the USB port and 3 LED to indicate system, WAN and LAN status. If you open the case, you will have a set to the pre-shoulder serial TTL connector and a fan connector. There are also GPIO pin on the board. The Ethernet ports on the R2S is different from the R4S. It has 1 internal gigabit Ethernet port and a USB 3.0 2 gigabit Ethernet port, which is powered by the Realtek RTL8211E Gigabit Ethernet chip. OpenWRT is fully supported on this device. At the time of making these videos, the R2S is running OpenWRT 21.02.3 stable release. The OpenWRT installation is very simple. All you need to do is download it the firmware and write it to the microSD card with Rufus or your preferred application. In this video, I will focus on the test and will not mention about OpenWRT installation process or the PPPoE setup. You can find the videos in the OpenWRT tutorial playlist. The link is on the video description. The below test will be done in this video: PPPoE with VLAN Throughput Test, OpenVPN and Wireguard VPN Throughput Test, 1-2 LAN Throughput with and without shortwave offloading, SQM QoS Test with cakes and PSUBCake. My ISP runs their PPPoE connections in VLAN 35. Currently, I'm using the 200 Mbps internet plan, but the speed test to their test server can go up to 400 Mbps at some time. To make sure the load is shared between 4 cores of the CPU, I have turned on the packet steering. Let's proceed with the first test. We are reaching 430 Mbps download speed with 40% loss of the CPU. We can see that the load is only on 2 cores of the CPU instead of 4. For upload, the speed is 220 Mbps with 30% loss of the CPU. It looks like upload consumes more CPU resources than download. Now, let's turn on shortwave offloading and see if there are any differences. Okay, 70% CPU idle with 430 Mbps download. That is 30% CPU utilization. Compared to the load without offloading, the CPU load had reduced by 10%. The same for upload, it is only 20% CPU utilization for 213 Mbps throughput. I have run the test again with hardware offloading enabled, and there is no much differences compared to the shortwave offloading. The CPU idle is still 70% for 430 Mbps. Let's move on with Wireguard VPN. The download and upload speed is different between servers. The maximum download speed I got is 200 Mbps with 38% CPU idle or 62% CPU utilization. The result is similar for upload. It reached 200 Mbps with 60% CPU utilization. For OpenVPN, the speed is slower because OpenVPN only utilizes a single core connecting to the same server with Wireguard. The maximum download speed I got is 41 Mbps. However, the speed is usually 10 to 16 Mbps when running the test with the speed test window application. For upload, the high-gate records 83 Mbps with 100% loss of one core, or we call it 25% CPU load. I'm not sure if the slow download is due to the configurations of OpenWRT or something wrong with the NanoPi R2S. If you have any idea, please share in the comment section. Now, the WAN interface has been changed to GSCP client mode, and the NanoPi R2S is connected to the upstream router. The MetroTech Routable 750GR3 running OpenWRT. Let's see what it wants to LAN throughput with OpenSpeedTest. I ran two tests, and the download speed is 600 Mbps and 700 Mbps. It is 100 Mbps different, which doesn't sound good. The upload is showing 754 Mbps, but I'm not sure if this is true because the theoretical gigabit throughput should be 940 Mbps. Testing with iPod 3, I can see that the throughput fluctuates from 700 to 900 Mbps, and the average result is 823 megabit per second. Let's enable shockwave offloading and run the test again. This time, the download speed with OpenSpeedTest go up to 892 Mbps, and the iPub test give the average throughput of 940 megabits per second. In both tests, the CPU is at 50% idle, and most of the load is shared between three cores of the CPU. Before enabling SQM QoS, let's do a quick ping response time check while running the OpenSpeedTest. Here, I ping the IP address of the upstream router, which is 192.168.1.1. We can see that the ping response time fluctuates and increases from 1 to 10 and then to 27 ms when the download speed passes 500 Mbps. We got the same result with shortwave offloading enabled. After searching on the internet, I decided to start the SQM test with 500 Mbps. For the queue, it will be cakes and piece of cake, and the overhead value is 44. We can see that the ping response time increased to 3 ms and then 6 ms when download at 485 Mbps. And it remains stable when uploading. Let's reduce the SQM speed to 400 Mbps and check again. This time, it is better. The peak response time is stable and it's only increased to 5 ms twice. Let's see how it is doing with 600 Mbps. As you can see, the peak response time fluctuates and this is not a good setting at all. Let's run the last test with 450 Mbps. So far so good. The ping response time did increase to 3 ms, but it is acceptable and there is no peak value. I really want to test the SQM QoS with downloading torrent files, but my internet connection is limited to 200 Mbps. So far, they know much difference when turn on or off SQM QoS when downloading. As you can see, the current downloading speed is 19 megabytes per second, but the ping response time from the upstream server is still 1 or 2 ms. The ping response time to Google Public DNS server is still 28 ms, and they know much changes when I turn on SQM. Even when the throughput of the one port reached 22 megabytes per second. So far, we have performed some tests with the NanoPi R2S. That is too long for a video, and I'm going to end it here. You may ask me, what are the conclusions? Well, it's hard to make the judgment at the price of the R2S is $35, while the R4S 4GB version is $60. If your internet plan is below 400 Mbps, the NanoPi R2S should be a good and budget-friendly option. It will also work in RAID with 400 Mbps without SQM. With this option, you can save half of the money to buy a gigabit switch to expand the LAN port. However, if you need a higher throughput and better OpenVPN performance, please go with the NanoPi R4S. That's all for this video. Thanks for watching and see you all in the next one.